It will be propelled by a sound. Somebody say, by a sound. Watch this, a sound of prayer. A sound of worship.
Well, this morning I'm very honored to share the pulpit with great men of God, and I don't take it lightly. It's only by the grace of God that I can be here this morning. Now, today is a very important day in the Christian calendar. It's Palm Sunday.
And
it's Palm Sunday this today. And I've spoken about it on Wednesday evening. But this morning the Lord laid on my heart, and I said this with the mother and father of the... I want to speak on sonship this morning. But I want to title my message or my ministry this morning, Becoming Mature Spiritual Sons. Becoming mature spiritual sons in the house of the Lord. Amen. So, what is a son? The question is, what is a son? The term son. Now, in the spirit, son is gender neutral. It doesn't refer to a male or female, because Paul writes in Galatians 3 verse 28, Paul says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave or free man, male or female, because we all one in Christ. There's no male or female. So this morning when I refer to a son, it includes the male, the females as well. So it is gender neutral. Now to inherit, your father or the family's wealth, the first thing is you must be a son. You must be a son. In the spirit, we are all sons, male and female. We are the bride of Christ, male or female. But to inherit, to become a mature son of God, you need to know the simple truths of becoming a son in the house of the Lord, a son in your biological house, a son in the spiritual house of the Lord. What does it mean to become a spiritual son in the house of the Lord? If you understand, or if you mature in the spirit, you will know that if you want to become a son, you have to know the simple truths of becoming a son. That's why Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 9, he said, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, what no mind has conceived. For those who love the Lord, you can see you will have all the benefits of becoming a mature son. All of us are sons, but are you a mature son this morning? Are you a mature son this morning? Now, to become a true son in the house of the Lord, you must discover the benefits, you must discover the opportunities, you must discover the responsibilities of being a son in the house of the Lord. That is what we require to be. You must develop a relationship with the Father. You must be in relationship. We are a relationship generation. So none of us operate without a relationship. You must have intimacy with your father. That is your biological father, your spiritual father, and God the heavenly father. You must be in a relationship with us so that you will be able to say, I am a son. I will do everything that my daddy do. I will do and I can do what my daddy do. So because I'm in a relationship with my daddy, I'm in a relationship with my father. And if you want to be in a relationship with your father, it's important that you need to deny yourself. You need to deny yourself. Listen to what Jesus says in John chapter 5 verse 19. He says, the son can do nothing for himself. He can do nothing without the father. You see what the father do, then he do likewise. So you imitate your father. In the house, you imitate the father of the house. I can do anything because I imitate my father. I do what my father do, and I do likewise. Now, the prayer of a true spiritual son of the house David writes in Psalm 51 verse 10, he says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Now some people say, no, I support you, I'm your son. But their heart is not with the Father. That's why we must create in ourselves a clean heart. Now in Jeremiah writes in Jeremiah 17 verse 9 and verse 10, he says, the heart is deceitful above all things. Deceitful above all things. But then he goes on in chapter and verse 10, he says, I the Lord search the heart and examines the mind. He examines your mind. Are you a true son in the house of the Lord? Are you true? He examines your mind. Your heart must be at the right place. You must be likewise, like-minded, like the Father is. Now the question remains, what kind of son are you in the house this morning? What kind of son are you in the house? I'm going to make the example of the prodigal son. In Luke chapter 15 from verse 1 to 32, it speaks about the parable of the prodigal son. Everyone wants to be a son. Isn't it so? You want to be a son, but do you want to inherit what the Father has set aside for you? And are you going to follow the process of getting that inheritance? You cannot skip the process in getting the inheritance. A lot of us, we want to skip the process. We want our inheritance now. We don't want to wait. Those who wait on the Lord will be blessed, but some of us want to skip the process. We want our inheritance now. Some of us even demand our inheritance before the time. And this is what happened to the prodigal son, the younger son. He demanded his inheritance before the time. He was self-centered, selfish. He didn't think what that inheritance will leave the family. That if you take your inheritance before the time, it has an impact on the family. How are the family going to operate with minus that inheritance that you took? So you must wait on the Lord. Your timing is not God's timing. God's timing is destined and it will prosper you. But if you take the inheritance before the time, surely it won't go good with you. Surely the Lord won't bless because you did not wait upon the Lord. So it's important that you wait upon the Lord. He was self-absorbed. Own interest, he put it above the interest of the family. So if you take your inheritance before the time, you only consider yourself. And the word of God declares you must esteem somebody else or anybody else above you. Not thinking of myself, I just don't want my way. It's what is interest, what is important for the whole house. How the whole house will benefit if I want to become a true son. This prodigal son, he did not realize that he could get a greater benefit if he waited on the Lord. He could only see in the now. But God sees the end. He sees, because he is the beginning and the end. He already knows what the end is going to be. So you have to wait. Now, because he demanded his inheritance, he could have been better off in the future. But he only took the inheritance. He was only there for the now. And he couldn't leave a legacy for his children, because he took his inheritance before the time. Now it's important that you wait. That you wait on the Lord. Growing and maturing with the Father. So you walk the walk with the Father. Just as Jesus, he took his disciples and he walked for 3 years with his disciples. What he did in that 3 years, he empowered them before he could send them. So if you want to be a mature son in the house of the Lord, you need to walk with the Father. Because the Father is the one that will empower you, that will give you the authority so that you can be sent. Now you're not empowered, so how can the Father send you? How can you represent the Father? Instead, the prodigal son grabbed his inheritance recklessly and he squander it in a short space, of time. So what does it say? The wealth that was given to the prodigal son was for proper investment. You need to invest. It was for proper stewardship. And this son, because he was immature, he knew nothing about spiritual stewardship. It was to produce a lifetime security and prosperity. But now he took it before the time. He wasn't prepared for the road that he had to walk. And inheritance must be passed on to the next generation. You must leave a legacy. Now, because he squandered, he just not cancel his own life. He didn't only make his own life short, but those of his children and the generations after the children. So it's important that you understand that you need to mature before you can take your inheritance. And you need to work towards your inheritance. Now, what kind of son does God want from us? What kind of son does God want you to be? Now, here's the thing. What does a spiritual son do? What does a spiritual son do? Just think about it for a moment. What does a spiritual son do? Here's the thing, church. A true spiritual son transcends position. It's not about position. It's not about the title. It's about the house. What's going forward in the house? It transcends the house. It transcends the authority of the house. It transcends the destiny of the house. Why? Because I'm in a relationship with my Father. I know what my Father wants. I know what He wants. He is going to make a way for me. So I must be under the authority of the Father. So it transcends position. It's not about position. If I don't have a title, then I'm not going to work with the Father. No. You must have spiritual maturity. You must grow spiritually so that you can walk this walk with the Father. Not just our spiritual Father, but our heavenly Father. You need to walk the walk with Him. You must be in an intimate relationship with the Father. That is what a spiritual son does. Second point is, true spiritual sons can be trusted. Are you trustworthy this morning? Are you trustworthy this morning? Because if you're trustworthy, your Father will send you, because you are under authority of the Father. He can allow you to do anything because you are trustworthy with the task at hand. It's important that we are spiritual sons that are trustworthy. We can rule any position. We can rule any situation because we are more than ambassadors, because we represent the Father before man. We represent the Father before man. Here's the thing, church. We're not just disciples. We're not just ambassadors. We are the flesh and the blood of the Father. We are the same DNA as the Father. One body, one expression, one image. That is what we are. We are the same DNA of the Father. We can be trusted with the Great Commission. Now, if you are trusted, your Father will send you anywhere. You can go anywhere because you know that son of mine is going to represent me there in a foreign country. If they send you, Brother B, Pastor B, if they send you to Kenya, if they send you to Ghana, you represent the Father of the house. And you know blessings will flow over you because you submit under the Father. That is what a true son does. A true son pays the price. I want you to listen to this. A true son pays the price. True son sacrifice everything for the work of the Father. They sacrifice everything for the work of the Father. Christ paid the price, and we are now in the most holiest month, and Friday we celebrate the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Now, the Father paid a price. And due to the fact that He paid the price, we are privileged to be called sons of the Father, because He has paid the price. He has paid the price for you. Now the law of exchange tells us the following, and I'm just going to mention three things. Christ became the curse so that we can receive the blessing. Christ became the curse so that we can receive the blessing. Christ endured poverty so that we can enjoy prosperity. The third thing, Christ took our iniquities on him so that we can receive his spiritual DNA, so that we can receive his spiritual DNA. We need, if you want to be a true son in the house of God, you need to suffer for the Father. You need to suffer. That's why Christ says in Luke chapter 9 verse 23, he says, if anyone desires to come after me, you need to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. Are we prepared this morning to deny ourselves and take up the cross and follow the Father? True sons take responsibility. You take responsibility. Sons on their way to maturity, they don't resist or blame others if it goes bad with them. No, they don't blame others. They know if all things work for the good, all things will work for the good. Because Paul writes in Philippians 4 verse 13, he says, I can do anything through Christ who strengthens me. I can do anything, but you need to take responsibility. Now, here's the thing, church. If you take responsibility, you complain less, you resist less, and you rebel less. You're not a rebellious son because you're under the authority of your Father. True sons inherit everything. Everything that the Father has in store for you, you can inherit it. The problem is, are you going to remain a mature son? Are you going to remain a prodigal son that would grab his inheritance now and squander it, and there's no future for himself and the generations to come? Are you going to be a responsible, mature son in the house of God? Now, true sons understand honor. We are high on honor. True sons understand honor. Now, honor is the seed for excess. Honor is the seed for excess. You can excess anything. Doors will open for you because you under the authority of your Father. You know the purpose of the house. So you can excess anything if you remain honorable. You must be honored. The Lord bestows honor, bestows favor and honor. But here's the thing. You need to stay humble because humility comes before honor. Humility comes before honor. In Psalm 15 verse 33, David writes and he says, humility comes before honor. Stay humble in the house of the Lord. Stay humble towards the Father, our Heavenly Father, our spiritual Father. Then it will go well with you. True sons understand process. Here's the thing, a lot of us want to skip the process. You need to go through the process. Now, if you compare the prodigal son and the mature son, now the older son, he was also going through a process. He didn't know himself, because when the father welcomed the younger son back and said, bring the best robe, bring a ring for his finger, shoes for his feet, the older brother was angered. He didn't follow the process because his life was still in the process. He was still developing. But here's the difference. There was a difference between the younger son and the older son. The younger son was a rebel. He was rebellious. But the older son, he was a maturing son because he was under the authority of his father. He was busy developing. He was busy developing. He was discovering himself. He was walking in his destiny. While the younger son was rebellious, he demanded his inheritance and he went to go squander. Are you prepared to go and squander your future this morning? or I want to be a maturing son in the house of the Lord. The older son, he had much to learn. He had a lot to learn, but here's the thing, he was determined to learn. The question this morning is, how teachable are you this morning? How teachable are you and I this morning? Don't worry about your qualifications. You can have 10 degrees. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you have 45 years experience. It doesn't matter what your youth is. The main thing is you need to stay humble. You need to show compassion. So let no one despise your youth. An Afrikaans is so een mooi gezegde wat sê, uit die mond van 'n suigeling sal jy leer. You know, uit die mond van 'n suigeling, a baby, you can learn. Sometimes, you know, when adults are in a discussion, the children will play there. And while you're talking, they will answer. And sometimes they will make a statement that shock you. They use, you see, now this is what the word says. Uit die mond, dit is waarom ek het in Afrikaans sê. Uit die mond van 'n suigeling sal jy ook leer. So let no one despise your youth as long as you are humble and you show compassion and you show the love. Then God will truly bless you. A son who stays under the teaching and instruction of his father will not only inherit everything, you will grow a loving person, a wise person, a prosperous person, a competent person in the earth. That is what Christ do, because Proverbs 13 verse 1 says, a wise son heeds his father's instruction. You listen to the instruction of the father. So if you listen to the instruction, you will have great influence whether you are at your school, at your university, at your place of work, in the marketplace, in the church. You will have influence if you listen to the instruction of your father. Here's the thing, it must be voluntary, sacrificial obedience. You must show voluntary, sacrificial obedience and be like-minded like the father. It is important. No one benefits from immaturity. No one benefits from immaturity. No one benefits from immaturity. You must become spiritually mature. Spiritually mature, that is what God wants from us. Sons drink the cup. Sons drink the cup. They don't pass the cup on. They do not ask somebody else to do what they are responsible for. Your responsibility is your responsibility. I can teach somebody else. I can empower somebody else. But I cannot serve my responsibility. I can teach somebody to even do it better than me. But I cannot serve my responsibility. If you are a son in the house, don't serve your responsibility. It's important that you drink the cup. True sons, apostle, true sons pay their way. They don't expect anything for nothing. If you go to Ghana, if you go to Kenya, you pay your way. You will be blessed on the other side. You will be blessed on the other side. But you pay your way. Listen what David said. David said, in actual fact, David would not want to make a sacrifice on land given to him. Why? Because he was a son. Why? Because he was a son. Abram paid for the ground Sarah was buried on. Why? Because he was a son. Paul worked with his hands not to burden the church because he was a son. True sons pay the way. They pay the way. True sons don't expect to receive something for nothing. They earn their way because they are under the authority of their father. Their father sends them. Their father sends them. True sons do not run from hardship because they know that their father covers their back. They don't run. They confront and they restore. They confront and they restore. And when they restore with love and compassion. They don't run away from confrontation. They confront and they restore. You know, they surrender. They surrender even when it hurts. They surrender. even when they hate it, you might be hating worshiping, you might be hating getting here quarter to seven on a Sunday morning. But surrender everything to God, because at the right time, your breakthrough will come. Your breakthrough is going to come. At the right time, your breakthrough is going to come. So surrender everything to God this morning. Surrender everything to God this morning. You know where your satisfaction lies. If you are a mature son in the house, do you know where your satisfaction lies? Your satisfaction lies in your sacrificial obedience. Sacrificial obedience. And you know where your hope is? Your hope is in the power of the Father. Your hope is in the power of the Father. That is where you receive it. Now, becoming a mature son, you don't look to anyone for a cutting edge of another person, because you know what the work of God is in your life, and that is your cutting edge that you need to concentrate on. You're nobody's groupie, because God has given you the authority, and you are under the authority of the living God. So you are nobody's groupie this morning. The Lord is richly going to bless you. The question this morning, church, is which son are you? Which son are you? We're not just want to become a son, but we want to be a maturing son. Everybody can be a son, but are you a maturing son that will administer his inheritance entrusted to him by surrendered obedience? Surrendered obedience, I'm going to administer the inheritance of my Father. Here's the thing, church. Christ is our pattern son. We have to look at our son Jesus Christ and see the character that Jesus Christ has. We must become like Christ and have the character of Christ. That is why we are called the Christ nation. Because we must have the character of Christ. We must fulfill that role in the earth. And a Christ nation is a servant to all. We must serve. That is the bottom line. We serve a hundred uswar. We serve in the house of the Lord. Because when you serve, you're actually exposing Christ unto the rest of the church. So it's important that you follow Christ. Jesus was a servant to all, especially the lonely hearted, the broken hearted, the sinner, the sick, and the needy. Christ served all of them. So that is the example that Christ said to us. While leaders in the church at the time of Jesus Christ were waiting for people to come to their temples, Christ went out to the hilltops, to the seashores, to the houses, to bring the people into the church. That is what the evangelists do. That is our commission this morning. As true sons of God, we need to go out, get the people in the house of the Lord. That is our commission. We need to win the lost at all costs. Bring them into the house. While the leaders was concentrating on the top of the food chain, Christ gave himself as the bread and the wine to feed the hungry at the bottom. Now, a lot of us, we just want to be there at the top, but Christ come to be low. Low, we must go and we must bow down. You must bow down this morning if you want to become a true son. He came to feed the hungry souls at the bottom of the food line, not at the top of the food line. If you want to become a true son in the house of the Lord, you need to have a connection with the Father. Now this morning, as I close, this morning it might be people that have no connection with the Father. And the invitation here this morning is, you have to take your stance for Christ this morning. Are you going to remain a prodigal son, or are you going to be a maturing son? Are you going to be a prodigal son that's still rebellious, that is still self-centered, that is not trustworthy, that don't want to take responsibility, that don't want to sacrifice? If you're still a son like that, this morning you're at the right place, at the right time, because God can restore you. Even if you don't have any connection with your biological father this morning,
Even if you have no connection with your biological father, Christ can restore you this morning. He can restore that relationship because he is a father to the fatherless. He is a father to the orphans. He is a father to the widows. This morning, you can be restored. The question is, are you going to be RSVP this morning? Are you going to RSVP? Are you going to react this morning? Christ is here to restore that broken relationship this morning. Maturing son this morning. As we stand this morning, the question is, are you a maturing son this morning? Do you want that connection to be re-established this morning? The invitation is here this morning. If you're that kind of person, you can step forward and the church will pray for you. You are ready to receive Christ this morning. Christ is here this morning to restore the broken relationship. Spiritual Father, he is here to restore that broken relationship with the Heavenly Father. If you have backslidden this morning, Christ is here to restore you. Give it up for Jesus this morning. This is what the Lord instructed me to do. We have 10 minutes left to do this. This is the season where God wants to be known more as Father than Jehovah Jireh, than God our banner. Those are all good things that God wants to be known for, but those things express your need for God to do a specific thing for you. But in this season of the church, the priority of what God wants to be known for is Father. This is such a powerful word. Romans 8 verse 19 says, the earth is in birth pains, awaiting the revealing of who? The true sons. That's you. That's me. The church has to process the revelation of sonship. I stand here as a father in the earth to this church more than a pastor. More than an apostle. I first stand as a father expressing the heart of the Father. That is what you need, the heart of the Father. Psalm 68 verse 5 says, a father, he's the father to the fatherless. He's the defender to the widows. He's God in his holy habitation. Do you know what that Elder Patience read there? Do you know what that means? He's God in his holy habitation. It expresses the position of where God is positioned. God's holy habitation is the highest position where God is. That means Father God is the highest acknowledgement you can give to God. This is what the Lord wants me to do. Every male in this house, just quickly step up to the altar. Every male in this house. Every male in this house. Warren is calling them from the parking lot. Every male in this house. I'm going to do for the ladies as well. Quickly come. Stand right up to the altar. Right up to the altar. Make space. Every male in this house. This is a powerful word. We're going to dedicate every male into this house. Not one male must be. Put a lady behind the camera. Put a lady behind the camera. Every male in this house. Just stand up front here. We believe we're going to do this for the ladies as well. I want you to raise your hand. I want you to raise your hand. I want you to pray unto God. I want you to pray unto God and make this commitment. This is a sacrificial prayer above everything that I need from God. That's not important right now. I know you need much from God, but your need for God and what you need from God is got nothing to do with anything today. It is you committing yourself unto God as a son and sacrifice everything that you want. But commit yourself to who God wants you to be. As Father God, He wants you to be a son. Commit yourself right now unto God as a son that submits in the earth to a father, so that you can express the heart of the Heavenly Father today. Come on, open your mouths, open your hearts, and commit yourself to the Father. And when you commit yourself to the Father, a position does not matter to you. What you get does not matter to you. If we moving into the sacrificial season where God says, I will send my son to die on the cross. Yes. give a son a high five next to you. And then I want you to go to your seats. And then I'm going to ask in the center all the ladies to come. I just needed to do the separation for a minute. All the ladies to come. The ladies have a unique heart as a son unto the Father. Ladies, the sonship is more than a gender specific, as you've heard the preacher preach. Sonship is a position in God. Sonship is a spiritual terminology more than it is anything in the natural that we think. I want you to stand before God and raise your hand and commit yourself as a son unto this house, as a son unto God. I stand as a spiritual father and I awaken the heart of the Father in you. God wants to supply every need. Psalm 65 verse 8 says he's the father to the fatherless. The fact that you don't have a father does not mean that you're going to become a statistic of this earth. But you have a heavenly Father, and he has a father voice in the natural speaking over your life right now. That all negativity, in prayer. The Holy Spirit just allowed me to see a few things in the service. What Elder Derek Patience ministered. As new believers, we see God doing things for us in a supernatural, miraculous way by giving things to us. This was just the thought that came to me. In other words, we needed this property and God gave us this property for R1 because of where we were in God. Do you understand that? When you become a matured son, anything else that God is going to bless you with, he's going to give you the money to pay for it. That just opened up to me. I don't expect it from nothing any longer. He will be provision, Father to me. Listen, I celebrate when I get it for nothing. Because he provides his supernatural God unto me. But I'm done with getting things for nothing. I'm at a point in my life where I can play a demand on a plot of land. Stand firm on your feet, and though you can trust God for things for nothing, but God. stand before you today. I declare prosperity, but through maturity, to raise us up in this time to become matured sons of God. Sons don't see things wrong. Sons fix things that are wrong. Sons don't complain when something is not right. Sons make it right. Sons don't drag other people around themselves to have a pity party. Sons gather people to say, let us fix this and let us sort this out. God is raising a breed of sons. Hallelujah. Father, as we release your people to leave this building, more than disciples, more than ambassadors, as true sons of the living God, that we will step up another level and let the vocabulary out of our mouths depict what we have heard today. As we approach this weekend of Passover, we believe that you are drawing closer to us. Good Friday morning, we speak a blessing over it. Good Friday evening, we speak the blessing of God over it. And on Sunday morning, we speak the blessing of God over it. Father, as we move through this week, we pray your hand upon us. Guide us, protect us under your precious blood as we release your people to go. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
It will be propelled by a sound. Somebody say, by a sound. Watch this, a sound of prayer. A sound of worship. A sound of word. Those are the three sounds that God is allowing to be released. There will be a sound of prayer. Thank God for the intercessors that prays every day at 5 o'clock. There's a sound of prayer going through our communities. There's a sound of worship being raised up. A new sound in music that God is releasing, and a sound of fresh word. Every prophetic era is preceded by a prophetic sound. Somebody say sound. A sound that will penetrate walls of limitation and division and change atmospheres supernaturally.